Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And just to clarify for my colleague from Montana, I think the origination of whiskeys for drinking and waters for fighting started in Colorado. But as Westerners, we do stand on common ground that state law ought to be respected. Water is a private property right. Our priority-based systems ought to be respected by the federal government as well. And Chairman Fleming, I thank you for holding this hearing today and shining light on a very important topic. In recent years, the federal government has repeatedly attempted to circumvent long-established state water law in order to hijack water rights. These efforts constitute a gross federal overreach and a violation of private property rights. On multiple fronts, the U.S. Forest Service and other federal land management agencies are currently attempting to ignore state law and take private water rights despite objections from elected officials, business owners, and private property advocates. For example, the Federal Forest Service attempted to implement a process that requires the transfer of privately held water rights to the federal government as a permit condition on national forest lands, while offering no compensation for the transfer of these privately held water rights, despite the fact that many stakeholders have invested millions of their own capital in developing those rights. Although the Forest Service has announced its intention not to require transfer of ownership of water rights to ski area special use permits outside the ski area permit context, the agency is keeping the policy on the books that requires permittees to transfer their water rights to the U.S. and apply for new water rights in the name of the U.S. These same nefarious tactics have been used in attempts to hijack private held water rights associated with agricultural production in the heart of rural America, where farmers, ranchers rely on these rights to secure loans as well as irrigate crops and livestock. This federal water grab has broad implications that have begun to extend beyond recreation and farming and ranching communities and are now threatening municipalities and businesses as well. Furthermore, the Forest Service recently proposed the Groundwater Directive, which would have expanded the agency's reach over the groundwater and established new bureaucratic hurdles to interfere with private water users' ability to access their water. Make no mistake, the Forest Service seeks to further federalize water resources, erode state authority, and pave the way for unilateral mandates on state water resources while overriding decades of longstanding law and policy that the states and the states alone hold jurisdiction over their own groundwater. Despite statements by Chief Tidwell that the agency is for the time being backing off its controversial groundwater directive, Chief Tidwell offered no guarantees that the directive or something similar will not be back in the future. In fact, Chief Tidwell noted that the agency still intends to move forward with it in some form after gathering more input. The need for permanent legislative solutions to be able to protect private water rights from federal takings and interference cannot be overstated. For these reasons, I'm reintroducing the Water Rights Protection Act, which passed through the House of Representatives with bipartisan support and out of this committee with bipartisan support in the last Congress. The Water Rights Protection Act would protect communities, businesses, recreation opportunities, farmers, ranchers, as well as other individuals that rely on privately held water rights for their livelihood from federal takings. It would do so by prohibiting the federal agencies from extorting water rights through the use of permits and leases and other land management arrangements for which it would otherwise have to pay just compensation under the Fifth Amendment of the Constitution. The bill also prohibits the implementation of the Groundwater Resource Management Directive recently promulgated by the Forest Service, as well as any similar directives or regulations they may consider in the future. The Water Rights Protection Act has already received the endorsements of the National Ski Areas Association, the American Farm Bureau, the National Cattlemen's Beef Association, the Family Farm Alliance, the Public Lands Council, and Club 20, and more groups continue to add to that support as well. You know, Mr. Oglesby, or Augsbury, is water a private property right in the West?
States, as I understand it, control the allocation of water rights. I am not the subject matter expert, and I would ask the committee's indulgence and permission to provide a more thoughtful answer for the record.
Well, I would certainly appreciate that. Since 1876, when Colorado became a state, the federal government has respected Colorado state law, Western state law, private property rights, our priority-based systems. But now we're continuing, as I've listened to the answers that you on the panel have given, is it your sense, sir, that we're actually seeing the federal government trying to find a solution for a problem that they have apparently not strictly identified.
Chairman Fleming, Ranking Member Huffman, Congressman Tipton, we certainly think that there is ambiguity in all of the proposals that have been the subject of today's discussion, and we actually would want to work more closely with those federal agencies to better inform their policy proposals.
You know, I have the National Governors Association. I think the comment was, and I does this concern you, when we are seeing the federal government now under state law, private property rights, state water law, now trying to define states as potentially affected parties. Does this seem to you to be a complete disregard of state law that has been respected?
Chairman Fleming, Ranking Member Huffman, Congressman Tipton, we certainly feel that we are more than potentially affected parties.
Thank you, sir, and I yield back.